You're tuned in to Just One Hot Mom with host Nanika Ansari. Get ready. She's about to bring you that fire, that flavor, that heat, all that passion, and more from around the world and in your neighborhood. Stay tuned.
Hey, hot people, it's your girl Nanika Ansari of Just One Hot Mom, and it is a beautiful day in the neighborhood as always, and we are in Cleveland, Ohio, so you know it's getting nippy outside. I'm not fully prepared for this weather, but I'm getting there. I'm kind of cute and toasty tonight with my girl in the studio.
Yes, honey.
Yes, and in case you guys don't know who this is, she is a powerhouse, so you about to know who she is. Hey, Sharita.
Hey, y'all.
Hey, and so we are in the studio today talking boss mom.
Boss moms.
And I couldn't think of anybody else to bring in because we are about to set it off. Sharita is in Cleveland making it happen.
Listen.
And if you don't know, you better get ready to know.
Better ask somebody.
So Sharita, tell us what you've been up to lately, boss mom.
Okay, so listen, before I say anything, first of all, shout out to all of the boss moms listening right now. Shout out to all of the boss moms making it happen in these streets. It's not easy, but you're doing it. Keep doing what you do. So what I've been doing is, first of all,
I've been busy.
Yeah. I've been real busy. Hey, Talia. Hey, Renetta. We have people on live. Hey, Sonia. What I've been up to is I've been working on a project called the Power Brand Summit. And the Power Brand Summit is basically the joining together of all of the best and the brightest media people, brand strategists, chefs, bakers, just a conglomerate of people coming all together on one day to really just talk about industry secrets, how to do the best events, how to have the best brands, how to get your team, how to do things without a budget, just some awesome, amazing stuff. And we found that it was so awesome and amazing. We launched this project about 3 weeks ago and it's already sold out.
See,
so I'm sorry,
what I'm
y'all.
Talking about. I know it's time for some moms.
Sold out.
So I was like, I wanted to bring Sharita on the show because I told her.
Sold out.
I get these questions all the time. Like,
yes.
I did a blog post like recently. Like, people are like, how do you do it all? And I'm like, you could do it too. You know, it's just a matter of making up your mind.
Yes.
And deciding to do it.
Yes.
So this evening, we are going to release some boss mom secrets.
Boss moms.
Because there's too many of you guys out here in the street with talent.
Yeah.
With passion, with fire, with flavor.
Absolutely.
And you should be able to do what we do, too. So, okay, Sharita, I'm about to ask you, what is your definition of a boss mom?
Well, my definition of a boss mom is, first of all, a woman who can admit that she can't do it all.
Ooh, I like that.
You know, because the thing is, everybody wants the woman to be the superwoman. And I'm learning that, especially if you're in a relationship, if you're a mom, if you're just a woman, period, we take on so much. And so the thing is, now we in this generation, because we feel like women, we work 24/7.
It never stops.
We're at work. We're moms. We're wives.
we're nurses, doctors, lawyers. Like, I don't know.
Librarians.
I run my resume down to people. They're like, you could do all that. I'm like, yeah. So can you.
Yeah. And the thing is, and outside of being all that, we're entrepreneurs. You know, all of these things that moms have to do, wives have to do, and we don't get credit for it. We don't, and 9 times out of 10, we're not even looking for credit.
And that's the messed up part about it, is that most of us are not looking. We just want to be able to do what we do. Like, I always tell people, like, I just want to live my passion, live my dream, and I want you to do it too.
Yes.
So get ready to come alongside me and do it.
Yes, yes. And the thing is, because we have a multiplicity of things, we have to be able to set aside time to not only be a mom, but also be a boss mom, which means you're not just a mom. You're also an entrepreneur female that's really getting into the business game and really learning what your ropes are, learning who you are in your industry, and not only just being in your industry, beasting that lane.
And that's the thing. So that's why I was like, Sharita, when we talk, like, Sharita and I, like, y'all don't know. If you ever come on the show, we probably have lunch together because I know I can get the nitty and gritty from you.
Right.
If I can get you over some food.
Right. Right. And she fed me, y'all. She fed me. And the thing is, I say, you feed me, I'm there. And I owe her a big old bag of Kit Kats. I didn't forget. I did not forget her big bag of Kit Kats.
The way of my heart is chocolate. But here's the thing. So I was like, let's come in. Let's try to tell some people, because I know that you are, you're urban design.
Yeah, urban classic design. I've been doing urban classic design under that company for about 19, give or take 20 years or so.
And so I remember in our initial, because I met Sharita even before this.
Yeah.
And so we were talking. She asked me in our first initial meeting, I said, well, can I meet with you? And I want to tell you about what I'm trying to do with my logo and all this other stuff.
Right.
And her first thing was like, are you trying to make money or no? Are you doing this because
if you're not, because the thing is, I'm gonna put it on the table. Everybody has a dream, right? Mm-hmm. Everybody has a dream, but the thing is, everybody doesn't have a reality. And the reality is, if you are going to be in business, you need to make money.
And so I was like, looking at her, like, are you okay? And I was like, well, tell me how I can make this money. She says, well, you need to learn how to monetize stuff. So I'm going to have her give y'all the same advice she got me. Because there are a lot of women out there who run. I know I've been to several networking events who run daycare centers.
Right.
Who are t-shirts on, who are designing multiple things. Mm-hmm. Yet they don't know how to go and get that money for what they're doing.
Well, there's a couple different dynamics. First of all, if you're thinking about having a business, every mom is actually a business owner.
Who?
Yeah. Like no, seriously. It's exactly. Anytime you run a business, it's exactly the way you run your house. You know when you have to get the laundry done. You know when you have to make sure the lunches are finished. You know when you have to check homework. You know when you have to pay the bills. The thing is, when you're strategizing meetings with people, when you are going out and networking, when you have invoices, all of those things are the same. It's just management.
And
that's the
thing, I think, but you know what? Because I was like, I was going to ask you this question, because it's one thing when you're in your household, there's no fear there. What I'm finding is I think people have a lot of fear of taking that next step and saying like, hey, I'm doing this little thing.
Right.
I can't stand when people say this little thing. Because
nothing is little. Child. See, that's called cuss words to Sharita Carthon. When you do something, you do it big. We don't, little.
That's what I was like.
Little.
Said, this little thing? Blog. I said, let me tell you about this little blog.
Little. So, if you're doing anything little, just don't do it at all. That's hobby. That's not money. That's hobby.
But most of the ladies I talk to are looking to not be little. And so what is it like? What are the factors, do you think, of fear that plays into that? Like, what do you think women are afraid of when it comes to actually being a boss mom, taking your business to the next level?
Because we put so much stress on ourselves, I think the number one fear is rejection. You know, we are so afraid that somebody is going to say no. But my thing is this, if nobody is saying no, then you're not doing it right.
Right. And I told Sharita, I was like, yeah, somebody told me no the other day. I just waited a couple of days and then I contacted them again and got a yes. And the thing is it's about your approach.
Yes.
If people can read fear on you. When you're scared
absolutely.
To ask something, people can totally tell. They can read that on you. So what I recommend you do, and this is for me personally, do your homework. Do your research. You have to know what you're talking about before you approach somebody.
Yep.
Whenever you're asking somebody for money, especially if you come to ask me for some money, ask yourself a few questions like, what am I really needing this money for?
Yeah.
And, you know, do I know my purpose? Do I know my brand? And I know you told me when we first met, that was a big thing. Like, do you know your brand? Do you know who you want to reach? What are you trying to do? Because if I didn't know that, then I wouldn't be able to do what I would do. So I remember I went home and I rewrote my whole purpose.
Yes,
statement.
I love that.
I was like, there was a purpose statement and there's a mission statement.
Mm-hmm.
And so I had to make sure that those were aligning with my vision.
Right.
So that I could do what I needed to do. So you said fear is one thing. What's something else that, I mean, well, you said being rejection.
Mm-hmm.
What's something else do you think stops people from the takeover?
The unknown. Ooh, the unknown. And then the next thing I will follow that up with is a comfort zones. Mm-hmm. Comfort zones. We are so incredibly comfortable with the people that we hang out with the circles that we're in. We are so afraid that if we for one second go out of that box or conference that we have ourselves in, that that we ask one person, the world is going to implode, and it's you know, things are not going to be right. So you really, 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 really have to be able to position yourself, number one, to accept no as yes. Mm-hmm. Okay. And then also position yourself to experience something that you never thought that you would actually ever experience.
And I said, I hope you remember this in the conversation we had. I was like, this has been my most uncomfortable year.
Yes.
Like, I've been so uncomfortable this year because I didn't know what to expect.
If you are comfortable, if you are having a conversation with any type of person that's positioned to take you up and you don't feel uncomfortable, get up and walk out and mm-hmm. tell them, I'm comfortable. We don't even need to talk no more.
After our first conversation, I was not comfortable. I was petrified. I was like, oh my God.
She's scared. Like, she's scared,
y'all. I gotta monetize all this stuff. And then she told me to go do this. And she said to put this out there and to put this out there. And in the back of my mind, I'm like, but it's just little old me. But once I took the limitations off of being little,
listen.
Like, first of all, when I pulled up this evening, I know Sharita heard me. I played my rock star. Before I come in here to get these shows, honey, Rihanna rock star gets played.
Okay.
Because, honey, I am a rock star.
Listen.
I wanted to let you guys know, if you boss moms want to call in and ask any questions, we can be reached at 440-252-0518. Again, that's 440-252-0518. So here it is. You're scared of rejection. You're scared of the unknown. You're scared of being uncomfortable. So it's somebody out there right now who is all of these things.
Okay.
How do we overcome that?
One day at a time. Ooh. I think sometimes we try to eat the elephant and we try to take stuff on every single day. Like, it's like, oh my goodness, I'm going to take, I have my dream. I'm going to do it. We wake up with this huge inspiration. Like, we've gone to some type of motivational, you know, conference. And you cannot eat. Listen, when they say Rome was not built in a day, it's not built. It was not built in a day. It wasn't.
It takes time. And I think that's what people like. We live in a microwave society where people expect stuff to happen instantly. Mm-hmm. And none of this stuff happens instantly. Like, I told people, I was like, I've been blogging for 3 years. You have? I'm like, yeah, because I knew at the time that it was something that I had to grow.
Yeah.
And in growing in your business, I've grown in my writing. Mm-hmm. I've grown, you know, and it's important, though, when you grow, though, that you constantly keep learning.
Yes.
I think that that's one thing where people fall off, like, you think you know.
Right.
You have no idea.
Listen. I cannot remember where I saw this, but it says the man that continues to believe that he knows everything finds that he knows nothing at all.
Ooh.
You know what I'm saying? Because the thing is, like, I know it all. I know everything. The second that you say that, you've automatically discounted your ability to move forward.
Yes.
And you're no longer teachable.
For failure.
Yeah.
And in that moment that you become no longer teachable, you might as well fold up.
Just fold it up. Just gone.
Because
just gone somewhere else.
All of these teachable moments that we have, you know what I'm saying? And remember, you have to learn from other people. Here's the thing, and I feel like in our society, especially amongst women,
mm-hmm.
is that we think we're afraid to share information.
Right.
So if I share information with you and you use it and you grow with it,
mm-hmm.
then that takes away from me. And like I always tell people, whatever is meant for me is going to be meant for me.
Right.
And so if me giving you some advice helps you out,
right.
that's just one more seed I've planted and I'm still flourishing.
Yeah.
See, I just don't understand why we're afraid to share information.
We're afraid to share because no matter how much you say it or don't say it, there will always be somebody who feel like you are taking something away from them. The thing is, this world is so big. Go in the middle. Go to China. Stand in the middle of the street. Forget China. Go to New York City right now. Like, go to New York City and stand in the middle of Times Square and tell me, out of the thousands of people, you can't convince one person to work with you.
And see, and that's the thing. I was like, you take the limits off of being afraid. You realize that whatever is meant for you is going to come your way.
Right.
And I have found more so not that when I've shared information with people, mm-hmm. that I've had so much to gain.
Yes, absolutely.
It's all about the, like, so last night I was telling you I had the connection.
Right.
And I was able to connect with some people there. And I kept saying, and I was like, Lord, I hope they don't get tired of me having the connection. But it really is. It's about how you connect with other people. And you don't keep that. You do more damage.
Mm-hmm.
When you keep the information to yourself.
You absolutely do, because I mean, the way human beings are set up, we're not set up to hoard everything to ourselves. I mean, I'm not saying like give all the secrets and spill all the beans. What I'm saying is we are crafted to have specific experiences, and we are crafted to go through certain things, and we are crafted to learn certain things that we are supposed to share. If we were not supposed to do that, why do we have the mentor-teacher dynamic.
Exactly. And that's the thing. You can't mentor or teach anybody without giving them something that you have.
Right.
And isn't that what we're supposed to do anyway? Each one teach one, plant the seed.
Plant the seed. Let the seed flourish. Exactly.
Or do you want a dead plant?
Listen. Listen, if the farmers in the field and in the cornfields did not plant all of that, all of those seeds that needed to be had, we wouldn't have anything to eat. No. You know, think about if the Farmers Association of Ohio decide we don't want to harvest cows no more. We don't want to harvest chickens anymore. We gonna keep it all to ourselves. We would starve, because y'all, I don't listen. I've cut up a pig before in North Carolina. It was a traumatic experience. I don't want to ever do it again. And so if they stopped right now sharing,
it would be a problem.
It would be a situation. I would go to them myself. Like, look. Okay, $10. I got 10 on it. Look, what can we do? Somebody, exactly. Because when everyone does their part, we all benefit.
And that's the thing. We have to realize that we need to come together as a community.
Right.
It takes a village. And we can't just talk about it. You got to be about it.
Yes, you do.
So here's the other thing. Uh-oh. We've given you guys some boss mom tips.
Yes.
Take the fear off. Take the limits off of yourself. But here's the thing. Because people always say this to me. Like, you have it all together. And I am broken.
Girl. She said we got it all together. No, we don't.
No, we don't. I said, that's the thing you have to that's understand, though.
Do you know what the most successful people have in common?
What?
They're all broken.
See? Broken. Raising my hand here.
I'm broken.
Because I was like, I think if I had it all together, I would be so messed up.
I would be bored.
Bored. I can't.
I would be bored.
I'm not a boring girl. So I was telling somebody that they're just like, you got this stuff going on.
Right.
And you got the kids and everything. And I was like, don't they usually tell you that the preacher's kids be the kids that act up the most?
Child.
So I said, what makes you think that the boss mom kid is not the kid that's acting up the most?
Ooh.
So I just feel like we don't have to have it all together. And that's right. What people are waiting for.
Yeah.
They're waiting to have it together. And I'm going to tell you this, like, even when you make your New Year's resolutions, which I do not do.
I don't either.
But when you're doing your thing and you're planning it out, you are never going to have it all together.
Can I share a story with you?
Go ahead.
When I want to say it was around 6 years ago or so. And I was just deciding. I used to work for Gannett USA Today newspaper chains. And I decided right in the middle of writing a story about a guy who was in a car accident. His car flipped around the tree and he died. I literally saw this guy die at the scene of the accident, decided that I didn't want to be in journalism no more. And so I sat down. I used to journal. I went back to journaling again. And I said, I am going to write out my life, because the way I planned it out, of course, tell God your plans, he's going to laugh at you. But the way I planned it out, I would just go and I would just do graphic design. Mm-hmm. You know, I just wrote everything out. And I felt like I know my plan. I wrote it all down. This is how it's going to go. And the thing is, of course, we always think that our plans is going to go in a straight line. And you know that picture where it's like, show God your plans. Okay, your plans is like this. And then God is like, nope, what, up there, down here, over there.
Spilled
milkshake. It's nothing compared. Even to this day, I had to literally tell God, you know, and I don't know, you know, if people are spiritual or not, but I believe in God. But I had a conversation with God, and I talked to God like he's my best friend, even though I don't treat him like the homie. But but I had a conversation with God, and I said, you know what? I wrote down all of these best laid plans. Nothing is going according to plan. As a matter of fact, it's going to the total opposite. So how about you take over? Jesus take the wheel.
I'm going to go ahead and sit
in this good old passenger seat, little warm passenger seat right here. And you tell me how to guide this thing. Because I know that there's things in me that I want to do, you know. And when things were not going my way, I did get disappointed, because I felt like I put out my plans and this is the way it's supposed to go. And I think a lot of boss moms do that, because we're always trying to put out the best laid plans.
And see, and that's the thing. I was like, I think I had to, like, when you take that hit of disappointment.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? It's just a matter. You can always bounce back. And that's what people don't realize. realize is that the bounce back is usually greater. You're like, okay, I learned this lesson.
The bounce back.
I got tagged a couple times.
Yeah.
But the bounce back is usually what's greater for you. And so I was telling people, like, I don't have it all together. And I don't claim to have it all together. Like, I want you to see me on Broken Cycles. This lady was like, oh, just one hot mom. She was like, well, how do you look? And I was like, girl, I can look like the people at Walmart. I can look like the people at Walmart if you catch me on a bad day. But I was like, I'm looking kind of cute today, so I hope I see you out today.
Listen, before I came in here, I had to go to the bathroom. You know what I'm saying? I had to get my little face on, because, look, sometimes it's rough.
And that's it, though. But here's the thing. This is what I want people to understand is that you are creating the best life for you. Like, your best life won't be the best life for me.
It's so true.
You know what I'm saying? So you have to be comfortable with the best life that's for you. I think we get so caught up in looking at what other people have and what other people can do, but you don't know that backstory.
Mm-hmm.
You don't know that woman struggles with depression.
Man.
You don't know that she is 1 foot close to eviction. You don't know what is going on in her life. She just not letting you see that. She just not letting
you see. I'm about to leave because she about to have me in tears, and I'm not about that tear life on the radio. You know, I'm up here on live, but yes, no,
but
you are so right.
Like, you know what? We get so caught up in what we think should be happening for us.
Yes.
And so I think when you take the limits off of your own thoughts,
mm-hmm.
and you allow, like you said, like I told people, my greatest connection is to God, because I already know when it comes through and he puts that idea here, he's going to give me the map to make it go forward.
Right.
But the moment I sit there and I'm like, well, Nikki, you could do this, Nikki, you could do that, the more I rely on myself.
Yes.
And the more I rely on other people, because there's been times that I have called people up like, can you do this for me? Can you do? And they haven't come through, and it's like, why are you relying on man to make something happen for you? That ain't I'm telling y'all, you have to learn these lessons. If you don't take nothing away from
this, learn
this part from us.
Listen, you know what somebody told me, and I keep saying this. I think Robert Hubbard of Hub's Groove said this over a live that he did a couple weeks ago, and he said, trust God, love people.
Ooh.
Trust God, love people. And when he said that, it just stuck with me, because the thing is, I think another one of our things, especially as moms, especially as wives, we get caught up in the idea that, well, especially as Christians, we get caught up in this idea that we have to love everybody and we have to trust everybody.
See, and that's two separate things.
It's two separate things.
You can love everybody.
You can.
My grandma used to tell us, you can love everybody, but you don't have to like them.
Exactly. Exactly.
I'm not a role with you.
Sometimes I don't like a lot of people, you know.
And that's okay.
Yeah,
and that's the thing.
It's okay.
You will figure out who your village is, who your connections are.
Absolutely.
And you know what? It may be somebody that's not in your life right now. That's what I have discovered.
Who is
so
my village? They got my village right there. All of y'all.
It may be somebody that's not in your life right now.
Yeah.
See, my sister and I talk about this all the time. It's perception.
Mm-hmm.
Your perception is that people are going to show up for you the way that you show up for people.
Mm.
And everybody's perception isn't that way. So when you take your perception and you just keep it with you, you'll be a better off person. I'm telling you.
Child.
I learned some lessons from our conversation. Child. And took notes when she
Listen.
Was talking. But I'm a lifelong learner.
Yeah.
So I learn from everybody that I interact with.
Yes.
So I got that perception from my sister, and I'm like, I got a boss up like
Sharita. Yes.
There are just a bunch of dope women. And in case you are following me, instead of doing my birthday wish list this year, I'm doing She's So Dope December.
She's So Dope December.
And I'm highlighting all the dope females I know in my life.
Yes,
so if you don't know them, get to know them, because it's a bunch of them. But so when you tell people that you don't have it all together, but they look at your life, how
mm-hmm.
are you breaking it down for them to say, like,
well,
this is just a look?
The thing is that the people that you actually say this to is a segmented group. Mm-hmm. All right. So it's actually the three top people who know the most intimate parts of who you are. And that's my husband, my twin sister, my best friend, Carmen Price. Okay.
Hey, Carmen.
Hey, Carmen. I know she's not on here. Hey, Carmen, bestie. My best friends. But then, and then there's my associate circle of people who, kind of know, but really don't have that idea.
It's how you do business different with different
people.
I do,
because the thing is, people that you actually do business with, you're operating in a business format, and so they don't see the totality of who you are. They see the business side of who you are. Mm-hmm. And the thing is, most business moms or entrepreneurs, we have a specific face, we have a specific voice, a specific disposition when we are operating business.
And so that's why I tell people, I'm like, there is, like, I was like, you're just one hot mom, just one. You might not catch me out looking cute.
Right.
That's okay. I see, you know, that is a, that's just,
right.
I try.
Right. We try. Yeah.
But you know what I'm saying? So when we break it down and I'm like, I don't have it all together.
Right.
That is the, like, one of the biggest things I could tell people. And I was like, you seem really confident. And I was like, yeah, but you know, it took time for this confidence to grow.
Right.
It didn't happen overnight. Like, I woke up one day and I was like, oh, I'm gonna be this and I'm gonna do this. It took time for it to go,
right,
to grow.
Right.
And so as it, and it's still growing.
Right.
I'm not kind of cocky now.
You can be cocky, it's okay.
But you know what I'm saying? It just took some experiences in life. And that's the thing where I think if you're starting out with a new business, you have to be willing to have some of those experiences. Like, don't
you do
let a lack of experience stop you from experience.
No. Actually, I think that should be your motivation. Just going back on something that you said about the confidence. Confidence grows through having experiences that you wish not to grow through.
Ooh.
Okay?
So
when you actually have a confrontation with the person who raped you and you forgive them, growth.
Ooh.
Confidence. You know, when you stand up to a bully and you say, I'm not gonna take this no more, and you pimp smack them in their face. Okay, we don't promote violence on but I'm just saying, somebody, you know, it's that's where confidence comes from. You know?
Okay, so I'm gonna take it a step further.
Okay, she's about to take it a step further.
When the person that you're afraid of is you looking back at you in the mirror, what do you do then? Because I can tell people, like, my biggest threat
is yourself.
Is myself.
Absolutely.
I'm the person stopping me from moving forward.
And that is a lifelong growth thing. And I think some people even get to their death and never are able to confront themselves. They'll confront everybody else because that feels more comfortable. We talked about the comfort zones. So when you're actually talking about confronting me, looking myself in the mirror, see, it's easy to say I'm a boss mom. It's easy to say
everybody
I'm this and that. Everybody can claim it. But the thing is, that woman that looks in the mirror and says, yes, I'm broken. Yes, I may not feel the best today. Yes, I may not be all that I feel I should be. Yes, I'm not that supermodel. I'm a size 16 plus plus plus, and I'm okay with that. That is the woman who can really stand in the midst of a crowd of lions and stand strong and, like, do what you got to do.
And have your own roar.
And have your own roar, yes.
When people are like, oh, you don't believe in competition. It's not that I don't believe in competition.
Mm-hmm.
I just know that my greatest competition faces me every morning.
Right.
And if I can get past her, not even get past her, if I can reach in that mirror, pull her out and say, hey, you're going to be okay today.
Right.
Then I know that I'll be okay and I don't got to worry about everybody else.
If we can accomplish that, that's where the greatest books are written. Because that is the number one secret to life, is how can I overcome myself? How can I look at myself in the mirror and literally not try to put that filter on Instagram to make myself look amazing? Look, you put that filter on Instagram, I do it too, don't you? It's okay. Look, she didn't want to admit it. But I'm just saying, it's just like, that's how it is, you know?
Hi, Peace. We're going to take a short break, and when we come back, we're going to boss you up some more, so stay tuned.
Yes.
You're listening to Elevations Radio, your station for uplifting lifestyle and wellness talk radio.
Saturday, December the 9th, 2017, at the Hungarian Business Trademint Center, 15805 Libby Road, Maple Heights, Ohio, 44137. Come join the incredible sounds of the MGM band and comedians performing with Cool TLC, Just Misty, Marcus Tarver, Cleveland James, Jasmine, and Mark Reedy. And the DJ, DJ Grandmaster L Dog. There will be a cash bar, food, raffle, and we're having a joke contest.
Hold on, wait a minute. I got a joke.
Yeah, y'all. That's right.
Doors open at 7 p.m. and we party till 1 a.m. Tickets are $25 in advance, $30 at the door. If you go to eventbrite.com and look up GF Productions, Cool TLC's Comedy Party, you get the tickets at a discounted price for a limited time only. Or call for your tickets at 216-395-7081. That's 216-395-7081. That's Saturday, December the 9th at the Hungarian Business Trademint Center, located at 15805 Libby Road.
I got something to say.
Mic check, 1, 2, 1, 2.
Can you hear me?
Mic check, 1, 2, 1, 2.
Is this thing? 1, 2.
We was having too much fun.
We was having too much fun.
Right, you got your earphone. Oh. Okay, so the reason why we were having fun is we started talking relationships.
Relationships.
And so we're going to take a turn a little bit because we've got some different variety of the type of relationships. So how can you be a boss mom and still maintain a relationship with a significant other? Because people think it's not possible. I think it is, but I think whatever you want to have, whatever life it is you want to have, you can have.
Yeah.
It's up to you. But people are always telling me, like, you can't have it all, and you can, and relationships is normally where things die. What do you have to say?
I would say this. Actually, maintaining a relationship as a boss mom it's actually easier. Because the thing is, the number one thing that you want your man to have is his own lane. Ooh. It's his own lane. And because there's so many women who says, I want a man, I want to be with a man, and I want him to have everything. First of all, like attract like, sweetie. So if he does, laws of attraction, it is what it is. I with my husband, I said, before we even got together, I looked at, I call it his work credit. Okay. And so,
listen,
his work credit. So I realized at the time that I first met him that he was with the Cleveland Public School District for 15 years. And so since I was able to see that, I already knew that he was the type of man that was loyal to his job. That he was going to keep a job.
And we base loyalty off of the wrong things. We looking at the wrong thing. Is he down for the hood? Stuff like that. See if that man done been on his job for 10, 15, 20 years. And then tell me if he's
exactly.
Loyal.
10, 15. Because the thing is, you already know the benefits are in place. Praise God. The benefits are in place. He has a sense of standing. So he's not going to go off and make irrational decisions that will actually affect the growth that you need to make or that you're making. And so if he does not have his own lane, you are already at a disadvantage, sweetie.
Well, see, then I told her, I said, the big thing for me is that whatever we can do separately, like if you have a goal or a dream and we doing it separately, us getting together shouldn't stop that. It should actually elevate that and take
Absolutely.
It to the next level. And
Absolutely.
If it doesn't, then you need to reevaluate the situation.
Mm-hmm.
But what I really want people to understand is that you determine what's best for you. We listen. Okay, so I could be like, hey, I'm on a Mark. Tell me how you got Mark and describe him. And does he have all of these qualifications? But Mark might not be what's best for Nick.
Right. And the thing is, you all are not going to like what I'm getting ready to say.
Uh-oh.
Stop going into these relationships with your list. Stop. Stop going into the relationships with your list, because when I met Mark, only thing I needed to do was have a conversation with him to know that he fit my list. If you women, if you stop for just 1 second, boss moms, if you stop for 1 second, first of all, I was a divorcee going into a new relationship with children. So, and he has children as well. So it wasn't like we wasn't, you know, we knew that we were getting ready to Brady Bunch. Okay. So only thing I needed to do was have a conversation with him. Sometimes women, we need to stop being so involved in what we think that we want. Sit down and have a conversation with people. Really listen and observe.
Listen
and observe the type of man that you are entertaining. Talk to his mother. You know, because women will say.
Because you know what type of mom you are. I always tell people, like, I know what type of mom I am about my son.
Yes.
So just imagine, that's the woman that you're about to meet.
Listen.
Her son.
Listen, you can't raise a man. You cannot raise a man. You cannot raise a man, ladies. You need to have a conversation with his mother. If he does not have a good relationship with his mother, it is a true indication of how the relationship that he's going to have with you.
And see, I'm just, so I'm glad we brought up these points. So I was telling her, I was like, if we can't build together, because so often, so many times, even when I had the dating show, the King's Court and the Queen's Court,
right?
And in there, they were like, well, you know, you need to be at home, cooking, cleaning, and doing all that. And I tell people all the time, I do all of that, but I still run my business.
Right.
And nothing is like, but it's a matter of, I need somebody that I can have a team with.
Mm-hmm.
And I have that solid at home.
Mm-hmm.
Like, somebody who's like, okay, if you got to go off and do your thing real quick, but then you still allow them to live their dream as well.
Absolutely.
See, we get so mixed up, we get so caught up that things have to be one way. Like, somebody has to sacrifice something. And you don't have to sacrifice if you guys can agree and be on the same team and understand what it's like to build a business separately, so that you can build each other up together.
Right. And I just want to go back on something you said. Before Mark and I actually got married, we had a conversation about expectations.
Yeah.
And that means, sweetie, what do you expect from me as your wife? Honey, what do you expect? expect from me as your husband? And that conversation included things about business. My husband is in music, which is perfectly fitted because I've been in music management and a music management artist, a music management artist manager for several years. So I knew what he needed. So the thing is, as a help me, you're there to complement. You're not there to complete. You're there to complement. So when he said, okay, I want to do this, I automatically saw how I could elevate his vision. And then also, it's a playoff because now I'm getting ready to do my own conference. He just did a successful his successful CD release at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. History, bro. History. Okay, that's what I'm talking about. When you're actually really thinking about having a relationship, it is a contractual agreement. Whether you think it is or not, you need to come in with a level of expectation saying, what do you expect from me?
And this is one thing I want to let the fellas know, though. My success does not make you less of a man.
Right.
My success should say, like, this, you're smart enough to know that you're with somebody successful. That just elevates the right. Your intellectual properties.
Right.
You should really know that.
Right.
Like, but all too often, I think we're intimidating.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you're intimidated by what your woman could possibly do, when you see her glowing, when you see her flourishing, then you start to be like, okay, she's going to want somebody else who's doing these same things. But let me tell you, if you rock solid and you're taken care of and you're communicating, you don't got to worry about that woman. First of all, it's too complicated to go somewhere else when you already got all these other things going on. I got to write a book, write a blog, do a YouTube channel, learn how to take pictures, show up at the radio station, work my accountancy job. I got all these things to do.
Right.
I ain't got no time to be trying to find nobody else.
You know what? And I think that every person listening to this will know who has ever been in any type of relationship knows that finding the right mate is difficult than a mug. And then keeping the right mate is difficult than a mug. You know what I'm saying?
And you know what?
In the age of side chicks. In the age of side chicks.
I'm going to bring her back on that one. She'll be back on the show because
that's a whole other situation. Oh, Lord.
We're going to bring you moms back because earlier in the first segment, you mentioned that we have this thing where we have to wear the cape.
Yes.
We're always expected to be doing more and do what we do. And this is what I recognize in the African-American community.
Mm-hmm.
We say that all too often. I'm just doing what I gotta do.
Right.
And then we just accept that as that's our lifestyle. And so I want to take that. I want to, like, just annihilate that whole conversation. Like, I'm just doing what I gotta do.
Oh, yeah.
How do we go above and beyond doing what we gotta do?
Okay.
And stop making that an excuse.
First of all, when you say doing what I have to do, I automatically think of bruh man from the fifth floor. You know what I'm saying? He be like, from the fifth floor. But we, first of all, and I hate to say this, our Caucasian friends don't say that.
No.
They don't say, we do, we have. They say, this is what we must do.
Mm-hmm.
In order to do business correctly or right, you know? And so even, like, you know, just going back to circling around about the Power Brand Summit, this is a joining of African-American power professionals that are going to tell you, if you don't do it the right way, you're already starting out at a disadvantage.
Mm-hmm.
Because what does the saying go? For us, we have to be greater than to be considered equal to. And so if we're already starting off with the mentality that says that we kind of, you know, we have to kind of, maybe I have to kind of do this, you know, I'll go get that flyer from, you know, the library and I can kind of, we cannot afford to kind of do anything.
I'm so glad
we must start. We must start at excellence in order to even be considered equal to, and not just excellence on one level, excellence on all levels, and consistently excellent on all levels to be considered equal to our counterparts.
And see, and that's the thing where I think we fail sometimes is you have to invest in yourself. So maybe you can't buy, and I am a shoeaholic. I don't want to lose my shoeaholic card when I say this, though. I am a shoeaholic. You can catch me at the mall. I'll have bags of shoes. No clothes, but I'll have shoes. But you have to invest. So maybe I can't buy 3 pair of shoes today because I need to invest in my business. Mm-hmm. I need to create my brand. Sitting down with Sherita was an investment in my brand. It's an investment in myself. If you're not willing to invest in yourself, why should anybody else buy into what you have going on? And I think that's sometimes where we miss it, is that we don't invest mm-hmm. in ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm excited about the Power Brand Bun Summit because I'm going to be sitting up there like, yes, this is an investment in myself. And even, here's the other thing. Sometimes the free stuff you do is an investment as well. Mm-hmm. It's an investment of time. Time is more expensive than some of the things that you're going to need to buy for your business.
Right.
And you have to understand. Like, I know one thing I've been working on is understanding how expensive time is and how to charge people for my time.
Child.
So how do you go about that, though? Like, because I'm confident in what I'm doing. You know, I'm in my lane right now. Who should people connect with to figure out mm-hmm. how to invest in their time and how much they should charge people for their time?
One of the top key people that is actually going to be there is Shante Roddy. She is excellent with business strategy, and any consultation with her is going to be worth it, where you actually sit down and understand your value statements, your rate cards, what actually you should be charging. But I will tell you this little bitty secret of the business world, is that the less you charge, the more you're not taken serious. So the thing is like, if you say, Sherita, can you do this graphic, this flyer for me for $5? And then you turn around and you pay someone else $50 for that same exact design, you're basically telling me, number one, I don't value what you do, even if it is excellent. Number two is I respect that person more because they came with a game plan that I couldn't deny, and they were firm on their prices. Think about this. You cannot go into Walmart right now and grab milk and cookies, walk out the door without a policeman saying, where's your receipt? Can mm-hmm. you? And so the thing is, I know that it's not going to happen overnight, but I really want African-American business owners, and not all of them, just the ones who believe that they can't charge their value. Think about every time you go into Walmart and get milk and cookies, about how you must pay for it. There's a demand of payment. If you don't pay for it, and if you take it, you know, and essentially when you're taking people for $5 graphic design, or taking people for $5 consultations, or taking people for $5 experiences, you're stealing from them.
Don't limit yourself to, I'm just doing what I gotta do, accepting whatever somebody is willing to offer you. Know your value.
No, know your value.
Know your value. And that's all about that research, though, again, because then I had to learn how to read analytics for social mm-hmm. media. Mm-hmm. It's all about learning that, researching the other people to make sure that you're a credible person, that people take you seriously. You have got to do your homework. If you don't do your homework, then you're stuck in the same position that you've always been in. And it's like a hamster running on the wheel. You just keep going in the same circle and you never grow.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's the mess. So let me tell you something, especially my African American moms with your cape tucked in and everything, we are no longer going to do what we got to do. We're
going to
do it. And that's just
period. Period. Make the investment. What I say is that when people come to me and they ask for brand management, I'm not just giving you a logo. A logo is not brand management. Brand management is being able to look at your entire brand, being able to see exactly where the holes are, actually being able to identify how you're not making money. You know what I'm saying? Just because of how your brand is set up. The thing is, if you're going to be in business, I'm not saying being in a hobby. I'm saying if you're going to be in business and you're not making money, you're in a hobby. I don't care how hard you're working.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And so when a person says to me, can you manage my brand? I'm saying basically you're asking me to be your money manager, because that's what we're going to do. We're going to find out the holes, make sure you're now getting paid for what you do. And we're going to start at the budget, whatever it is that you have, and we're going to elevate that, because the thing is, money growth means that you're growing personally. Okay. Mm-hmm. And so the thing is, if you once I started out, I mean, I maybe charged $20 for design, but then I got better and I started studying my craft and I started studying people in my genre, you know, and being able to do different things every single day consistently for the last 20 years. So over the last 20 years, I should have learned something.
And I'm going to shout out my blogger friends from the Brown Love blog, because we were just challenged in that blogger group to study other bloggers.
You have to.
Like, if you want to build, if you want to do more with what you're doing, yes, you got to study the people who are doing what you're doing. I think that's where, if you're a makeup artist, study other makeup artists. Don't just go on there, take a picture, and think you could do it. I'm going to need you to go get a whole makeup kit, start planning it. I'm going to need to see you do some things. That's just like, I can't do graphic design.
Yeah.
So you know what? I stay in my lane and I don't do it. But if I did want to do it, you know what? I would study Sherita to find out how to do it. You have to learn that it's a billion of us doing the same things, mm-hmm, but only you can do you like you do you.
Shout.
So, here is what I want you to give us.
Okay.
Because you know I'm going to ask for something I already asked.
Okay.
There is a woman out there right now,
yeah,
who's like, I'm not a boss mom because I got these kids at home. I'm not trying to run a business. All that. Like you said, the mm-hmm family is a business. There's somebody, though, that's, their confidence is just not where it needs to be. Give us three tips for those boss moms.
Okay. I would say three tips definitely is, number one is, know that you don't have to be where everybody else is. You know what I'm saying? And I'm going to get the other two, but I just want to expound on this first one a little bit, is that everybody is not a mega entrepreneur. And that's okay. Everybody is not a mega entrepreneur. You could be a mom that's at home, and every single day your child goes and sits on the toilet a certain way, and you like, man, if I could just shift the toilet seat one way. But then you find five other moms that you found out that their kid sits on the toilet a certain way, and you're like, oh my God, you can just use what I did, and they have perfect aim. And I know that's kind of graphic, but I'm just saying, it entrepreneurship is the organic ability to be yourself and also get paid doing that. You know what I'm saying? So when you are able to sit down and be yourself, and then find something within your boss mom mode that you're already doing, and it could be used to help another mom or another mom in Sweden or something like that, that's when you take the thing that you have and you can take it to that next level. So number one, definitely be able to identify and say to yourself, I don't have to be super. I could just be myself and figure out my own little lane and do me just right from here. Number two, I would say, once you find out what that is, be the best at that one thing. And it don't have to be, it doesn't have to be, you don't have to be the LeBron of it. But be the best so that people be able to notice and identify who you are, what you do, and how they can get it from you. The third thing I would say is, once you have identified at least something, even if it's a blog, set yourself up to get paid. Okay? Set yourself up to get paid. That means you need to have some type of website, some type of e-commerce store, some type of Shopify. Everybody is online right now. It's a buying season, not just in December, but all year long. Mm-hmm. This new generation is now buying everything online. Literally 85% of millennials purchase everything online. So, and there's no, you would be fascinated to know that cat socks are like the number one selling thing in like Turkey.
It's a trendy topic.
Cat socks, y'all. But listen, somebody in Sweden loves cat socks enough that they keep paying for it. And that's the only thing you need. You know what I'm saying? Is to set it up so that when you know exactly what it is that you're actually going to do, do not be bashful in making sure that there is a place that I can take the money out of my pocket and put it into yours. Because if you don't do that, I can't give you my money. And now you're at a loss and so am I.
Oh, so you guys got that. Like, Sherita, tonight, this conversation, I knew this conversation was going to be fire. So I already was expecting it. I wore my Just One Hot Mom shirt so that she could see, like, I'm branding everywhere I go. I would walk through the mall with this shirt on. Yes. But I was like, you just gave us some nuggets. And so I'm really hoping that people take men and women alike. It's just so we so happen to be some boss moms.
Yeah.
And so, but take that information and use it, because here it is. You've got something that somebody needs. So,
listen, We were all, I'm not saying just one person. We all, every single human being on the earth has something. Something that they can give. Now, some people are meant to work 9 to 5s. Everyone is not meant to be an entrepreneur, and that's okay. But there are a group of people who know, because you know God is intentional. Mm-hmm. He'll be, hey girl, hey girl, you know, listen, it's time for you to go ahead and get on that invention that I put in your spirit a couple years ago. Go ahead and just do it. Do it afraid. I do everything afraid. I did this summit afraid and sold out in 3 weeks.
And you, I know what you thought. She was like, you better hurry up and go get your ticket.
It's my first summit.
It's about to sell out. I'm like,
It's my first summit. It's my first.
I'm
in
so
Cleveland.
Proud of you. I'm
in
so
Cleveland.
Happy for you.
I did this in New York, like, so I don't know if that counts.
And that's the thing, though. I think that it counts. But that's the thing, and I'm going to wrap this up because you just really did give us some good advice. I hope you, girl, the replay is going to be a mess. I'm going to have to do some commentary on the
replay.
But what I want you guys to understand is, like, don't be afraid to build each other up.
Don't
be afraid to put somebody on a pedestal, because you never know when they're going to reach back and lift up behind you. We have to get out of this crap in a barrel, man.
Yeah.
I think Reggie Clemens said that on the live feed. Like, people think in a crab in the barrel mentality, but we can't think like that if we really want to grow our businesses, mm-hmm. and especially if you want to grow the business in your own neighborhood. If you're looking in your backyard, you got to support the people in your neighborhood.
You do.
And the lack of support is going to be detrimental to our communities. You guys have got to know that if we don't show out and show up for one another, that it's going to kill off our communities.
Mm-hmm.
So, hot piece, I'm going to leave you with this piece. Go on over and check out my blog and how I do it all, or go on over to the YouTube channel, because I do drop some nuggets on how I do it all. And it's mainly what we talked about here is about staying in your own lane. When you can focus in on what you want to do with your life and you don't have to worry about what everybody else is doing, you'll be better off. You'll grow that business. You will take that chance. You will step out and do what it is you have to do. I work with a boss lady all the time. Robin Hill, owner of the radio station here, stepped out. She took a chance on the kid right here and told me to come on over to Elevations Radio and to do my thing here. And so it's all about taking a chance on yourself. No matter what your dream is, if your dream is cat socks, and recently I seen like cat jewelry for their butt. Like, I'm going to share that because it just amazed me that somebody would buy that. But there is someone out there waiting on you, and they're waiting on you and only what you can do. And it's like, and I won't do it the same way you do. Like, I tell people all the time, it's like, I could go upstairs and ask my 5-year-old daughter, like, can I wear your shirt? And she gonna look at me crazy.
Right.
But she gonna give it to me to see if it fit. And guess what? It won't fit. It's going to be probably really uncomfortable to get off. I might get it on one arm or whatever, but it's going to be really uncomfortable. And stuff that's not for you won't be for you, and you'll be able to push it to the side. But the point is to keep pushing forward.
Yes.
So I need for you guys to go on over and check out Sharita at Urban Classic Design. Go on over and check out the blog Just One Hot Mom on all my social media, and justonehotmom.com if you want to read up and listen to a replay of the show. And support elevationsradio.com, because we are bringing you that fire, that flavor, that heat, all things saucy from around the world and in your neighborhood. So I need for you guys to stay tuned. You ready, Robin? You ready to take us out? Talk to you soon.
That's another rap.
My name is Gwendolyn.